It's a few days before Christmas, and I'm on my way to a very special interview with the Stevens, Isserlis and Doane, to hear more about their beloved teacher, Jane Cowan. I always remember Jane being quoted during my formative years, and I've been keen to share more about this unique lady I've heard so much about. Jane studied with Emmanuel Feuermann, took over the running of the International Cello Centre in London before moving the centre to her family home, Edrom House, in the Scottish Borders. It was during this transition that the Stevens had their first encounter in the 70s, and they share their stories here about their friendship, as well as about the extraordinary legacy of Jane Cowan. It was such a joy to be able to eavesdrop in this conversation, and I hope you enjoy it too.
Maybe a good place to start would be just before we talk about Jane is how you both met, because that was a moment, wasn't it, when you came over to England, Steve?
Well, as we were just talking actually about the first time we met, which I think was 1970, when I was 11 years old. I'm not sure we even met. We must have heard each other.
Yeah, we were at the same music course in Cascais, Portugal. I went to meet Eisenberg because I knew he was a disciple of Casals. And I couldn't get to Casals. I found some old letters from me writing to Martita, even in the 60s, trying to get to the man, and a director of the Casals Festival. But Eisenberg seemed available to do classes. And John Gwilt, of all people, and I didn't realize this till much later, saw my letter. And between he and Millie Stanfield, they got me a scholarship to go.
Oh, really?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
So there was a Cello Center connection. And at that was 1969 or 1970. 70. And
this what did you play? Because I wonder if I remember.
I was practicing Lalo quite a bit.
But what did you play to Eisenberg?
I might have played him Debussy.
I don't remember that. I remember Fauré sonata.
That's Eddie Battersby was playing that, those, and he's the first one that was raving about Fauré to me.
Quite right.
Yeah. But anyway, Stephen was playing on a small cello.
Well, I wasn't. I played a little concert, but I wasn't in the class. I was just listening. I was too young. I was 11. Yeah.
But Chandervaeg was teaching fabulous master classes.
Oh, yeah, I didn't even know about that.
And I went along to those, and that was a huge, that was really inspiring, because not only was he a great musician, but he made sense about physical balance at the instrument, and he sort of seemed to, it was the first time I'd seen somebody that had a system technically that seemed to be in alignment with their musical values, and it was a bit seamless the way he was working.
Holistic.
And that was pre-IMS pressure coat.
Yeah, only just actually. Yeah, 2 years pre.
Wow.
Yes, but Vegas, not the nicest man in the world. You weren't there when he... Oh, hello, Macadamia. You weren't there when he... He said to that girl, he was getting more and more frustrated, trying to teach her bowing. She wouldn't get it. And eventually said, "Why are you not talented?"
Oh, dear.
It's not the most encouraging thing.
Oh, dear. Yeah. Well, the next time we met was it 7 years? No.
76.
70, it was 70,
I think it was 76.
75, 76, anyway. It was.
No, it would have been 76. No, it was 75. That's 75. Right.
75. October or something?
Yeah, in Bristol.
The Imperial Tobacco Cello Competition.
Right. Couldn't have that now. Tortelli's competition. And we both got knocked out in the semi-final. And Steve didn't have anywhere to stay in London, so we offered that he could stay the night at my parents' house, and he stayed 8 months.
Well, in my defense, while I was there for close to a week, one of the lodgers, one of the singers, and I think it was Diane, but I don't remember, she moved out, and his mum could tell I was very happy and grateful to be there and have a roof over my head, and said, "Well, why don't you pay me a modest sum per week and help with the washing up, and you can stay." So I sure did.
He paid a modest sum. And don't know about helping with washing up, but he stayed.
Yeah, I started spying.
I remember you saying you used to spy on Steve.
I started spying on his practice. I was utterly baffled by the system that he was using.
Utterly aware. I remember once you, in the dining room, there was a sort of cornice up there. And there was you stood on the sort of window ledge. And propped yourself up on this cornice, so you were on top of me, looking down on me, trying to see how I bowed.
I was trying to work out the angle bowing concept that he was using, which was to me completely like I'd studied in more of the American school where everything was perpendicular to the string all the time, or else, and he was breaking many of the rules that I'd thought I had to stick with, and somehow it was working rather well. And that's when he introduced me to his teacher.
Jane Cowan.
Uh-huh. Yes.
But first we were I was just there in the house, and we were making extraordinary lunches when your mom was away, I remember.
Yeah.
Some spaghettis where we started with stuff and kept adding things.
You did. Cooking has never been my forte. Yes, that's right. It was fun. I would come home from the holidays and there you'd be. And then I can't remember how far on you met Jane.
Well, I think within a few weeks, she came down for some.
That's right. She used to come down to London occasionally, although she'd moved to Scotland by then.
Yeah. Was that the International Cello Centre?
Well, I think that year was the year she moved. 75 or 70? No, I think 75 was when she moved to Scotland, but she came down occasionally to give classes in London still. And that's probably where you met her.
I went round to Leverett Grove for a lesson in the front room, wherever she was teaching. And then I also heard a concert of, was it an end-of-term concert? Or a mid-term concert of the pupils you all played? I remember meeting Michael there.
Michael Martin.
And there was this extraordinary sound coming out of this assembled group of cellists, and it was like, and I was supposed to go to Bill Pleath, and your parents said, well, Bill's wonderful. And of course, he taught Jackie Dupre and everything. But they said, you really should play to Jane before you go along to Bill. And that's when I think I went for a lesson. You guys must have somehow...
I'm sure we did, yeah.
...introduced us.
I can't remember the details, and I'm sure you were deeply suspicious at first, because she was so different from anything you'd experienced. I mean,
well,
she was different from anything anybody had experienced, really.
I don't know if you've ever had that experience where you feel like somebody's looking right through you, and it's a bit...
A lovely plant over that. Yeah.
Anyway, it was quite...
I remember you used to say you felt that she's kind of saved you in that moment.
Well...
Looking for something.
It took more than a moment, believe me.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And there were some quarrels, I think, some explosions.
Yes, yes. The first... But I played to her, we did some work, and then she said, oh, you've got some work to do. And I was like, oh... I guess we do, because I had played to Amaryllis Fleming, who I think I told you that story. I went to her. This was before I was thinking I was going to stay at the London Musical Club.
Oh, yeah.
And I got there on the day after somebody had committed suicide, so the whole place was practically shrouded in black. And then I went around to Amaryllis, and I went up the stairs to her place, and I tell you that story.
I'm sure you did.
I played the Alamon from the Sixth Suite in my usual, like, slightly suspended manner. And I finished, and she was smoking a cigarette with this gold cigarette lighter, and there were beautiful portraits, which I didn't realize her daddy, Augustus John, the great portraitist, they were all over the place. The paintings were everywhere. And she said, oh, you must have a marvelous upbow staccato. I said, why do you say that, ma'am? I just played you a very slow piece. She said, because your bow arm is such a wreck. And that was my introduction to Amaryllis. I was like, oh, dear.
She spoke her mind.
And that was after we'd had our encounters with Tortelier.
Oh, yes.
So it was...
Who tore both of us to shreds.
Yeah, he did indeed. And so it was when I met Jane, I realized that she noticed there were some issues, but she thought she could help. And
And Stephen, you knew her from 8 years old, is that right? You were kind of
probably nine. I went to her when I was 10, and I doubt she would have allowed me to stay with another teacher more than 1 year. So I was probably about 9, and then when I was 10, she said, you have to come to me, or you'll never be a cellist.
And that was in London?
That was
some years before she moved up to
school. Oh, many years, yeah. So that must have been, about 68, 69. When was I? So I was 10 in 69, because I was born the end of 58. So it was around 69, and she'd only just moved down. She'd been in Winchester, where her husband was head of music at Winchester College, and then, in fact, John Gwilt was invited to take over the Cello Centre, and John Gwilt was her sort of amanuensis, really. He was her right-hand man, and so she came with him. It was always seemed as if it was her Cello Centre, but only much, much later. A few years ago, I read an article by John, in which he said, I was asked to take over the Cello Centre, which amazed me, because she always talked about my centre. It was interesting. You never would have thought it.
John was such a very modest and kind of retiring person.
Very pleased about John because I edited the Dvorak concerto for Henley. And actually, I still use, because he gave me most of the fingerings with which I first learned the piece. And I still use several of them. So in the introduction, I said I'd like to thank John Gwill for giving so many fingerings and bones. And then Dawn, his wife, wrote to me and said, John's dying, I'm afraid. So I wrote to Henley, I said, is it ready yet? Can you send the first copy to John? And he got it a few days before he died. And apparently he was very pleased. That's nice.
Well done.
I'm glad the timing worked out.
He was the sort of magnetic center of the cello center, in terms of keeping the cello center ticking over, I think.
Yes, he was a quiet figure.
Steady, kind of.
We could never... Yeah, I mean, he was obviously very attached to Jane. And she was very dependent on him, too. But he was definitely her assistant. She was... Mm. She made no secret of that. She was the main figure. I mean, she was so charismatic. He was very quiet. He was a wonderful musician.
I told John I learned the fourth suite from listening to it through the wall because I was in the bedroom next to his, and he'd get up in the morning and start practicing his Bach.
Yeah.
And I said before I'd even studied it, I'd been memorizing it through the wall. It was quite a wonderful model, too.
Yeah, he practiced Bach every day. But Jane was, as I say, the main figure. She was completely charismatic, completely mad. Quite scary at times.
Yeah, I was thinking, I went for a swim today, and I was thinking she was alternately ferocious and compassionate.
Yeah,
and you never know which side you were going to get.
Exactly.
But fortunately, they balance each other out.
She wasn't for everybody. Some people made no progress with her. Some people couldn't stand it. Left, and some people stayed and made no progress. But for those she could help, she was magical. Like you.
You played her very frequently when you were younger, did you? Once told me you played her several times a week.
Yeah, I had about 5 lessons a week. I used to be at the Cello Centre six days a week.
Incredible.
After school, I would go every day. And then at the weekends as well. So, I could say she was a big influence.
And you often refer to the fact that she called your parents and basically adopted you and said, you're coming to Scotland with me.
We did beg her to adopt us. She wanted to adopt us. My parents weren't very keen on the idea, but my mother adored her. My father didn't so much. He somewhat resented his children being taken. I mean, because all three of us, my sisters Annette and Rachel as well, were very much under her thumb. My father had his reservations, which I completely understand now. We used to go for courses in her big house in Scotland, and then eventually she moved there, and I moved there with her for 2 years. I was a full-time student there. And then Steve... Actually, you were there after. We weren't there at the same time as full-time students.
Well, you had started to... I think I might have been there the last term where you were there a lot.
Yeah.
Because I was there in the spring and summer term.
Oh, yeah, in 76.
And then that's when Pietrogorsky had passed away, and Stephen had been invited to join... You'd been invited to join his class.
Yeah, and I had all this money set up. And Steve said, well, why don't you go to my old college, Oberlin? So we swapped teachers. I went to his old teacher, whom I'd heard a lot about from Steve.
Kapuscinski. I'd love to hear a bit more about Kapuscinski, but obviously we'd want to... Should we speak just briefly about Kapuscinski?
Yeah, he was a wonderful man. I mean, for him, he was a huge figure.
Well, he was kind of my cello papa all the way through undergrad, and a very powerful, supportive figure, too. Stephen went to him as a formed player, really.
Well, I was very much... Jane was my main thing, and so he was... But he brought me down to earth a bit, which was a very good idea.
I remember telling him when Stephen was going to come to him, and I don't remember if he'd even heard a recording of your playing. He kind of knew about you, because I'd written a fan letter. And I said, one thing you have to promise me, Mr. K, we used to all come, Mr. K, you have to listen to him for a half an hour before you say anything, because he's very strong in his opinions. And he said, I can't believe you told me to do that.
Really?
And yeah, he said, well, I did what you said, Steve, because you stayed with them the first weekend you were there.
Well, except my cello was lost. He got lost.
I know. I think it went to San Francisco and back.
Yeah, something like that.
And it was James Testori.
That wasn't right.
Anyway, it came back in one piece. But apparently you were practicing, and he said, so Steve, I did what you said. I sat at the bottom of the stairs and just listened to it.
Oh, yeah.
And he teased me about that for many years afterwards.
He was a lovely man.
And did that make you see Jane in a whole new light? I mean, because you'd been brought up with her, basically.
Yeah, not really. She was still, I mean, even, you know, after I'd been studying with him, I would go back to her. Uh-huh. I was back in Britain for lessons. She was my teacher.
And she studied with Feuermann?
Yeah, she studied with Feuermann and Tovey as well, Donald Tovey. And she'd known Casals. She was steeped in that world. She'd been great friends with Yeli Derani and Adela Fakiri, who were the nieces, I think, of Joachim. That was her tradition, very much Central European.
So, because you know, as sort of young budding students, you know, when we were studying with both of you from my generation, you know, these sort of catchphrases would come out like "tyranny of the barline" and
these quite right.
"Thou shalt not bore" and things.
Those were hers.
And so, you know, obviously. They've stuck with you in your teaching, and so I'm just curious, like, what is it? What is the magic in Jane? You know, in her teaching and in what
well, she was very holistic. That word I used before about vague. I mean, you really couldn't separate technique and music. I mean, she could teach technique very well. I mean, she could teach bowing amazingly, but it was all you were always very conscious about why you were learning to do this sort of bowing.
Where, on gut strings, of course.
On gut strings. Yeah. She was fanatical about gut strings. Sort of, you know, anybody who has any sense would be. There's funny, there's three cellists around this table, and only one of them plays on steel. I wonder which one. Mentioning no names.
Oh, I think I might.
You've got a couple of gut on the bottom.
Couple of gut, is like saying, I'm Jewish, but I'm half circumcised.
Oh, well, I was going to say about the same thing about Jane.
Changing subject quickly.
Yes, exactly. That there was a connection, exactly what he's saying, a connection between technique and the type of technique she taught. She called it the transcendental technique, the technique that shouldn't be noticed because it's so natural. And she had a ridiculous intuitive understanding of how things worked on the cello and could demonstrate and show it. And she was quite analytical about it, too.
Mm. And about music.
Yeah, I was looking at those notes from your lesson book, and she said you have to analyze the phrase direction and make your bow distribution mathematically precise to serve the arc of the phrase.
Exactly what I say now.
Exactly. You could, and I think you were working on the Walton, the theme in Variations of the Concerto, and there were copious notes on that page about exactly where you needed to be in the bow to get to the arrival point and go across the peaks.
But also she made me read some Sacheverell or Sitwell, who was, you know, to show me Walton's aesthetic world, which is also very useful.
I'll bet.
And she made us read Racine and Goethe. It's holistic, as I say.
So not just focusing on the playing and the technique, but actually the larger...
Yeah, she made us listen to Mr. Solemnis at every course she gave, and it was very broad, and there was harmony lessons and theory lessons, well, same thing, and we had to sing madrigals, and yeah, it was very...
We had to sing for our supper sometimes.
Yeah, always sang before supper.
Before dinner.
Alle Augen warte auf die Herr, und du bist in jeder Speise zu seiner Zeit. Stays.
She said we couldn't play German music or French music properly until we could at least speak the words, even if we didn't weren't fluent, that we needed to understand the I guess you could call it the agogic underpinning of those languages, which she called, didn't she talk about French being the langue pas accentée, not so much strong accents, but more
she may have
horizontal line. I remember her talking about
certainly the sound of the language and the aesthetic. It's Racine's birthday today. The day we're talking on. December 22nd. Same as my sister Rachel. And Puccini. Anyway.
And so she was very much steeped in the whole concept of relaxation and playing and how essential that was, and that it should be
the technique should just be the ability to relax, really. So you didn't have to think about technique. That's a good technique for her, I think. And it's true. Most of what she said is true, except there are some things. I think she was very harsh on some composers, who I think are, you know, she didn't like Bruckner, really. She didn't really like Mahler. She didn't like Britten much. She didn't like Vivaldi or Telemann. I think she was, yeah. We had to outgrow that a bit. Realise she was a bit extreme.
And she performed a lot until a certain point, and then she...
I don't know how much she performed. I don't think she can perform that much. I met very few people who'd heard her. I think she suffered from nerves, probably. But sometimes when she played, it was beautiful.
Yeah. Sometimes she'd lead the Cello Centre cellist in her own arrangements, and of course she knew it all from memory.
Yeah.
And I'd peek in if I wasn't part of it, and there was this just explosion of amazing sound coming from the music room.
Yeah, we all played cello club in London every week. We had cello club. I used to enjoy that. And she made lots of arrangements for cellos, which were great. But her, you know, her passion for fore, for instance, I completely, you know, I was brainwashed by it. It's become a very important part of my life, fore, and Schumann as well. And of course, Beethoven, Bach, of course. But she certainly moulded our tastes as well, our musical tastes. I must say, I've never warmed to Delius, whom I think she really didn't like. She really didn't like Wagner. That's okay. But she adored Fauré, she adored... I think she really liked Ravel and Debussy, but Fauré was the one for her.
She was a huge fan of Couperin, I remember.
Yes.
I was taken to task for not practicing my Couperin at the keyboard because it would inform my Bach.
That's right. She used to yell at us for not knowing enough Couperin.
I think Crinan demonstrated the Les Barricades Mystérieuses, you know, and had... as trying to do a bit of that.
So we couldn't understand Bach unless we understood Couperin, which is funny because Bach was actually quite critical of Couperin himself, but he did admire him. Just thought he was too ornate, apparently.
And what was it like moving, you know, being out of the city, you know, up in Scotland, away from, you know, the life that you then
like,
went to?
Well, it was a bit too small. I mean, at one point, I think there were just four of us. The most there ever were 12. And it was
David
a bit too intense. I don't think he was ever full time.
Okay.
No. But he used to go to courses and visit and things. But no, Jamie Birch, guitarist, who sadly died.
Michael
Martin, whom I've known, he's a cellist who now lives in France. Very sweet, wonderful guy.
Amazing.
She wasn't that easy to him, I must say. He gave him a very hard time, but he survived.
Justin Anderson, right?
Justin Anderson, who's now quite a successful businessman in Brighton. And Andrew Wardell, who really does not speak well of her. He's one of the people who really didn't like her in the end. Mm. I mean, there were these people. She was a strong character, and she had quite a temper. And you never quite knew whether she was going to wake up in a good mood or a foul mood. I remember once, because Michael Martin and Jamie Birch and I all shared a room at one point. We were actually giving a concert that day for two cellos and guitar. And suddenly at 8 o'clock in the morning, the door burst open. Minus, hospital workers and sewage workers have been up since 6 so that you can study music. Get up! She sort of left.
Can't really argue
a rude
with
gesture
that.
Came from our beds. You didn't.
Must have given such an amazing energy, though, for all of you as you were.
Yeah, it was quite scary.
It switched you on, you know, every day, it seems like. There wasn't a moment you could be just sort of passive or.
No,
you know, just...
definitely not. I probably coped best with it because I was, you know, I'd been with her for so long and it was easiest for me. But still, sometimes she'd decide I was going to be a disaster. I was wasting everything she'd given me and I was never going to be a cellist. Yeah. Pressure there was, but inspiration there also was.
one of my abiding memories is watching you playing to her in a class or in a lesson, and watching the two of you kind of discuss and sometimes argue, but rather good-naturedly, if I remember correctly.
I don't remember that.
But, yeah, it was...
It's possible, but, you know, by the time I met you, I'd already been studying with her for
And you were concertizing, and you and Peter Evans were playing duos, and
that was the very last lessons I had with her.
Yeah, that was... I was kind of at the tag end of that, of that.
But I still learned things from her even when I went back. But still, you know, as you say, teaching comes out in our teaching. I'm sure. I mean, we teach in a very different way. You're a proper teacher. I'm not. I'm a coach.
Yeah.
But she's still a big influence.
I think when I've been listening in on your classes, that I hear echoes of...
Definitely.
Of her a lot.
Well, I think she was right about many things. So.
My pupils get probably, I don't think they get tired of hearing me quote her, but it happens multiple times a day.
They probably do get tired of it. They're just too polite to tell you. But I mean, I don't bow in the way she taught me to bow at all. I just bow in my own way.
Mm-hmm.
But somehow she enabled that by teaching me the bowing she did. I'm just horrified at some of the teaching I hear, or any instrument these days, and I compare it with her. I mean, she was so, you know, the music came first.
Mm.
You got to know the music, you got to teach the composers as friends. You didn't do sort of stupid, try and keep the bow even the whole time. What's the point of keeping the bow even? It's like talking like this. What is the point of talking like that? She actually made us use the bow as a living thing, a musical thing. And so on.
Breathes.
Breathing. Yeah. Talking, as well as singing.
Yes, you talked about the diaphragm being the basis of your posture when you're sitting with the cello. I remember that. I was like, I'm not a singer. Wait a minute, what's going on here? And it was, and she talked a lot, principles from yoga, I think she talked about.
Yeah, although she would be very scornful if somebody went. It's like she influenced the early instrument movement a lot, but then she was very scornful about that too.
Yeah, she had her own way.
But actually, she taught many of the people who sort of started it in England, at least, and Holland. But then she turned against it. She heard what they were doing. But that was her. She was contrary.
I remember Jonathan Manson and Catherine Manson grew up in the next village, didn't they?
No, very close by.
Yeah. So they were coming in for lessons. I remember walking into the music room and you were playing the Schubert Quintet. Really? Jonathan was all of them, maybe 13.
He had
an old cello with a... apparently they'd put a bedpost on for a neck or something, but it was functioning rather well, and there was a big sound coming forth.
He's still rather amazing.
He's amazing.
Oh my God, I heard him at the proms in the St. John Passion. He played the cello aria, put it down, played the gamba aria. I couldn't do that. Catherine's amazing too. They really are. They knew Jane possibly earlier in their lives than I knew her. They are definitely much influenced by her.
Amazing. Any last thoughts?
Do you have any more questions?
Well, I'm just eavesdropping here. I'm just loving hearing. I know that, Stephen, you've written things on your website about her, and I enjoyed looking through that. And also the notes that you've kept, that you've passed on to a few of us, are just fascinating, because she was more than just a cello teacher. She was, she was going into whole worlds of literature.
But there was no contradiction in that.
It was all
towards the same goal.
Yeah.
But I mean, you and I had very different relationships with her. Because, you know, I was like a son to her at the age of 10, and you came as fully formed, if in a bit of trouble.
Yes.
But she really helped you in a very major way.
Yeah, she had... I was sort of forced at that point, and I kind of knew I had to rethink my entire approach.
You were a bit of a wreck during Bristol.
I told Stephen when we met, I was in a state of theatrical despair.
Well, there was that film from you playing in Bristol. Oh my God.
In Bristol?
Yes, sort of your mouthing sort of prayers as you play.
Really?
You did not look happy.
Don't think I've seen this. Maybe it's a
I
good
think you
play.
Saw it a bit and you freaked out.
Oh dear. Well, I knew things didn't feel like they were working, and I needed somebody to help me. And I'd been sailing along quite comfortably, and then it sort of wasn't comfortable anymore.
Classic. But that's why you're a much better week-to-week teacher than I am. Because I've never really worked out what I do, and I don't want to. Whereas you had to work it out.
Well, I was forced
to. That's why you can teach people how to do it.
Well, some days.
Which is great.
Some days.
Yeah, you're famous for it.
I asked Starker what happened. He said, delayed child prodigy syndrome.
Really? You said that?
I said, what happened?
That's
but,
good. He was wonderful.
He
too.
Became a big fan of your work.
I suppose in his way. I was a big fan of his. We got on very well. I loved him. But that was very different from Jay.
Yeah, for sure.
No, I mean, Vague was much more similar. Very, very different personality. But the same basic values. All my main teachers. I always say I had four great teachers. Jane Cowan, Sandor Vague, Radosh, and Kotak. So three Hungarians. And they're all, you know, they're very different ways of saying the same things, basically. All idealists. Kind of idealists, which are the main, I think their main concern is to make the music live. And she really did that. And you would play to her and you suddenly found yourself playing better than you thought you could possibly play. And suddenly everything made sense suddenly in the music. That was inspiring.
It's hard to put your finger on how she did that.
Well, she talked about, she would laugh at the jokes in the museum, as she always, you know, and that's so important. I don't know how people can play Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven without a sense of humour. And she would just roar with laughter at the jokes in the music. And that's absolutely stayed with me. I mean, there are bits in the Beethoven sonatas and variations that still make me laugh as I'm playing. And I guess, you know, if you were another school, you would think, joke, Beethoven. That's just rubbish. There are so many jokes. He's got such an incredible sense of humour. Haydn's is more obvious, maybe, but Beethoven's is just as strong. And that was very important. And then she would talk about their lives, and you really feel they were friends. Which is, you know, for a child, is wonderful.
Now, I've said my bit, but I'm enjoying listening to these stories.
I think I've said my bit too.
Thank you both so much. It's such a pleasure to be able to share.